Hello friends, I welcome you all to today's lecture on Sitridhana, Hindu women's property. The basic aim of this module is to discuss the meaning and definition of Sitridhana, classification, source and rights of women over Sitridhana, protection of wife's property under criminal law. Sitridhana. The word Sitridhana is composed of two words, Sitri meaning woman and Dhana meaning property. The word Sitridhana means the property belonging to a woman or woman's property. The Smriti writers did not define the word Sitridhana. According to Manu, the following six kinds of properties were included in it. Gifts made before the nuptial fire, gifts made at the bridal procession, gifts made on account of affection by father-in-law and mother-in-law. This includes gifts made at the time of making obeisance at the feet of elders just after marriage, gifts made by the father, gifts made by the mother, and gifts made by the brother. To this, the following categories have been added by later Smriti writers. Gifts made to a wife on supersession, that is, at the time of taking another wife. Gifts made subsequent to the marriage by husband's relations and gifts from sons and relations. According to Yajnavalkya, I quote, "What was given to a woman by the father, mother, the husband or a brother or received by her before the nuptial fire or presented to her on supersession and the rest is denominated Sitridhana." So, what is given by kindred as well as her marriage fee and anything bestowed after marriage, unquote. Vijaneshwar, the author of Mitakshara, expands the meaning of it by using word adhya, that is the rest, which subsequently include property obtained by a woman by inheritance, purchase, partition, finding, and seizure, that is adverse possession. Whether a particular kind of property could be termed as Sitridhana would depend upon the following factors. The status of the woman at the time of acquisition of the property, that is whether she was unmarried, married or a widow. The source wherefrom the property was acquired and the school of Hindu law to which the woman belonged. Sitridhana. Classification, source and rights of women. The Hindu Succession Act 1956 introduced a sweeping change which, subject to certain qualifications, now confers full and heritable capacity on a woman in regard to all property acquired by her, whether it may be before 1956 or after. Consequently, the woman now holds the property in her possession as a full owner and not simply as a limited owner. Before the passing of this act, property owned by a woman could be classified into two categories. Property of which she was an absolute owner, that is Sitridhana, and property of which she was a limited owner, that is woman's estate. Two types of women's property differ in their origin, enjoyment, and ultimate devolution. A woman's estate consists generally of property obtained from inheritance or property obtained on partition, whereas Sitridhana can be acquired in various ways. In the enjoyment of the former, a woman could not alienate the corpus of the property unless there was necessity. While in the case of later, the woman was the absolute owner of Sitridhana and had the full freedom to dispose of it at her pleasure with some restrictions thereon during the period of coverture. Upon a subsequent birth of a son or on subsequent adoption or upon her remarriage, a widow's estate was liable to be divested. This is not so with Sitridhana in any case. The former devolves on the next heir of the last male owner, who are called the reversioners. It does not devolve on the woman's own heirs. In case of the latter, on the death of a woman, Sitridhana, however, goes to her own heirs. Before 1956, there were two kinds of women's property, Sitridhan and women's estate. As per Section 14 of Hindu Succession Act 1956, the women's estate has been abolished. The Privy Council in Devi Mangal Prasad versus Mahadev Prasad observed that property inherited by a woman, whether from a male or a female, is not her Sitridhana. This is the rule well settled in Bengal Madras school, but the Bombay school holds the view that such inherited property is not Sitridhana. Only if it is inherited from a male by a widow, mother, or other female entering into the gotra of the propositors by marriage. Similarly, property acquired by her on partition is not her Sitridhana property. In Bhagwan Das versus Maina Bai, the Privy Council held that the property inherited by a widow from her husband was not Sitridhana property. In another case, Shio Shankar versus Devi Sahai, it was held that the property inherited from a female, for example by a daughter from her mother, was not Sitridhana property. As to the share obtained by a widow on partition, it was held in Devi Mangal Prasad case that it was not Sitridhana property. This is the law of Banar school and it governs all the Mitakshara schools. But in Bombay, it is firmly established that property inherited by a woman is her Sitridhana, except where it is inherited from a male into whose family she has entered by marriage. As held in Sham Kaur versus Dath Kaur, property held by a woman by adverse possession and unrealized rents and profits accruing from property given or bequeathed to a female during her widowhood and property purchased from Sitridhana is also Sitridhana. Whether a property acquired by a woman from other sources is Sitridhana or not will be determined by the status of the woman and the school to which she belongs. The source of acquisition and the time of acquisition are also the factors to be taken into consideration for deciding the question. The time of acquisition refers to the period of maidenhood, period of coverture, or period of widowhood. Daya Bhaga school believe that gifts and bequests from strangers obtained during coverture are not Sitridhana. Similarly, if the woman inherits property from a male into whose family she has entered by marriage, such property is not Sitridhana. If the woman survives by her husband, gifts or bequests from strangers during coverture becomes her Sitridhana after her husband's death. Daya Bhaga or Bengal school defines Sitridhana as, I quote, that alone is Sitridhana which she has power to give, sell or use independently of her husband's control, unquote. The result is, it may be said affirmatively that all gifts from relations constitute Sitridhana, except a gift of immovable property made by the husband. And that gifts from strangers also constitute Sitridhana if made before the nuptial fire or at the bridal procession. Negatively, the following properties are not Sitridhana: property inherited by a woman, property obtained by her on partition, gifts from strangers except those made before the nuptial fire or at the bridal procession, and property acquired by her by mechanical arts. Source: a Hindu female may acquire property from various sources. Several descriptions of property that may be lawfully acquired by a Hindu female as Sitridhana according to all schools are: gifts and bequests from relations. Property given or bequeathed to a Hindu female by a stranger during maidenhood, coverture, or widowhood, by her parents and their relations, or by her husband and his relations, is Sitridhana. Gifts and bequests from stranger. Property given or bequeathed to a Hindu female by a stranger before the nuptial fire or at the bridal procession is Sitridhana. share or partition. It is not Sitridhana and it does not pass on her death to the Sitridhana heirs, but reverts to the sons or grandsons out of whose portions it was taken out. Property given in lieu of maintenance. Money paid to a Hindu female periodically for her maintenance, and the arrears of such maintenance or a lump sum of money given to her in lieu of maintenance constitutes Sitridhana. Property acquired by inheritance. Property acquired by inheritance by a woman, either from male or female, is not Sitridhana. She takes only a limited interest in the property, and on her death, the property pass not to her heirs, but to the next heirs of the person from whom she inherited it. Property acquired by mechanical arts. Property acquired by a Hindu female by mechanical arts or otherwise by her own exertions during maidenhood or widowhood is Sitridhana. Property acquired by compromise. As to the properties obtained by a woman under a compromise or a family arrangement, there is no presumption that she takes only a life estate. What she takes depends on the terms of the deed and other circumstances. Property obtained by adverse possession. Property acquired by a Hindu female, whether during coverture or widowhood, by adverse possession becomes her Sitridhana. Property purchased with Sitridhana. Property purchased by a woman with her Sitridhana and the savings of the income of Sitridhana constitutes Sitridhana. In general, a woman is in absolute ownership and full power and control of disposition, either by transfers inter vivos or by will, over her Sitridhana. She has therefore the following right in regard to it. Possession and enjoyment. She has absolute and exclusive right of possession and enjoyment of it. Her power of disposal of Sitridhana is absolute. And on death of the woman, the Sitridhana property devolves on her own heirs. This is provided by the Hindu Succession Act 1956, sections 15 and 16. Statutorily, it now becomes her absolute ownership property, unrestrained by any condition whatsoever. The old law of succession in this regard is totally abrogated by the Act, removing all the traditional limitation on her power of disposal. Hindu female property under Hindu Succession Act 1956. Section 14 of the Hindu Succession Act 1956 provides: property of a female Hindu to be her absolute property. Any property possessed by a female Hindu, whether acquired before or after the commencement of this act, shall be held by her as full owner thereof, and not as a limited owner. Explanation to this section says, property includes both movable and immovable property acquired by a female Hindu by inheritance or device, or at a partition, or in lieu of maintenance, or arrears of maintenance, or by gift from any person, whether a relative or not, before, at, or after her marriage, or by her own skill or exertion, or by purchase, or by prescription, or in any other manner whatsoever, and also any such property held by her as Sitridhana immediately before the commencement of this act. Nothing contained in subsection 1st shall apply to any property acquired by way of gift or under a will or any other instrument or under a decree or order of a civil court or under an award where the terms of the gift, will or other instrument or the decree, order or award prescribe a restricted estate in such property. Section 14 of the Act is to confer absolute ownership on a female Hindu. It has brought about fundamental and radical change in the position and status of Hindu females. The reason for the enactment was to ensure to women equality to status and of opportunity with men in relation to title to and enjoyment of property. Now the position is that the Hindu female will no longer hold the property as a limited owner, but as an absolute owner. Harak Singh versus Kailash Singh. It was held that the object of the Hindu Succession Act was to improve the legal status of Hindu women, enlarging their limited interest in property inherited or held by them to an absolute interest, provided that they were in possession of the property when the act came into force, and therefore in a position to take advantage of its beneficent provisions. The cumulative effect of Hindu Succession Act 1956 as amended by 2005 Act is as devolution of interest of coparcenary property. In a joint Hindu family governed by the Mitaksha law, the daughter of a coparcenar shall, by birth, become a coparcenar in her own right in the same manner as the son, have the same rights in the coparcenary property as she would have had if she had been a son, be subject to the same liabilities in respect of the said coparcenary property as that of a son, and any reference to a Hindu Mitaksha coparcenar shall be deemed to include a reference to a daughter of a coparcenar. It will not affect or invalidate any disposition or alienation, including any partition or testamentary disposition of property which had taken place before the 20th day of December 2004. Any property to which a female Hindu becomes entitled shall be held by her with the incidence of coparcenary ownership and shall be regarded as property capable of being disposed of by her by testamentary disposition. Where a Hindu dies after the commencement of the Hindu Succession Amendment Act 2005, his interest in the property of a joint Hindu family governed by the Mitaksha law shall devolve by testamentary or intestate succession under this act and not by survivorship, and the coparcenary property shall be deemed to have been divided as if a partition had taken place, and the daughter is allotted the same share as is allotted to a son. Protection of wife's property under criminal law. A Hindu married woman is absolute owner of Sitridhana and can deal with it in any manner she likes. Thus, a Hindu woman can file a civil suit for the return of such gifts and items of dowry if and when she is forced to leave her husband's home. There is a conflict of opinion whether she can apply under Section 27 of the Hindu Marriage Act when some proceeding is pending under that act. The majority view is that Section 27 is not applicable in respect of the exclusive property of the wife. Thus, under civil law, she has a remedy filing regular suit for the said relief. The wife has also a remedy under a criminal law to file a complaint under Section 406 of the Indian Penal Code. In Pratibha Rani versus Suraj Kumar, the Supreme Court observed, I quote, the mere factum of the husband and wife living together does not entitle either of them to commit a breach of criminal law, and if one does, then he will be liable for all the consequences of such breach. In the case of Sitridhana property, the title of which always remains with the wife, though possession of the same may sometimes be with the husband or other members of his family. If the husband or any other members of his family commits such an offence, they will be liable to punishment for the offence of the criminal breach of trust under Section 405 and 406 of Indian Penal Code. It cannot be said that once a woman enters her matrimonial home, she completely loses her exclusive Sitradhana by the same being treated as a joint property of the spouses. In other words, if this view is taken in its literal sense, the consequence would be deprive the wife of the absolute character and nature of her Sitridhan and make the husband a co-owner of the same. Such a concept is neither contemplated nor known to Hindu law of Sitridhan, nor does it appeal to pure common sense. it cannot be also said that once a married woman enters her matrimonial home, her Sitridhana property undergoes a vital change so as to protect the husband from being prosecuted even if he dishonestly misappropriates the same. For instance, properties like jewelry, clothing, cash, etc., given by her parents as gifts, cannot be touched by the husband except in very extreme circumstances, viz., where the husband is in a serious distress. Even then, the religion and the law enjoins that the husband must compensate the wife, and if he cannot do so, he must pay fine to the king, which means that the husband would be liable to penal action under the present law of the land." Unquote. Further, the court said, I quote, "The husband, being only a custodian of the Sitridhana of his wife, cannot be said to be in joint possession thereof, and thus acquires a joint interest in the property. It is an extreme travesty of justice for a court to say that whenever a married woman demands her Sitridhan property from her husband, she should be dragged to the dilatory process of a civil court and her husband would be debarred from being prosecuted by a criminal court." Unquote. Even if the Sitridhan property of a married woman is placed in the custody of her husband or in-laws, they would be deemed to be trustees and bound to return the same if and when demanded by her. While concluding this lecture, it may be said that Sitridhan is that part of a woman's wealth which she alone can sell, gift, mortgage, lease or exchange. A woman's right to her Sitridhan is protected under law. The 2005 amendment has brought tremendous change in the position of women by including them in the purview of co-partner and bringing them to such a position that they share equal rights with male members. With this, I conclude my lecture on Sitridhana. Hope you have enjoyed the session. For now, it's time to say goodbye. Stay blessed.